Session 3. Boy, it's fun when you have time. You can see there's a lot to talk about. So when I go in and they give me 1 hour, you know, it's really a bummer. So I'm going to ask 4 questions. If you notice on your program, this session is titled Food Freedom or something like that. Food Freedom. And so I'm going to ask a couple of questions and then go from there. The first question is, in any culture, how do you encourage innovation? I'm a big believer in trying to come to common ground with people who might disagree with us. How do we, holistic management is big on this. You get all the stakeholders in the room and you go for big common ground questions, and then you can kind of, you know, go from there. And so my common ground question is, do we want to live in a culture that encourages innovation?
Yes.
Can anybody think of anybody who would say that we don't want to live in a culture that encourages innovation? Nobody would say that. All right, so we all agree. All agree. I mean, from the raw milk advocate to the commissioner of the quota dairy law, we all agree. Yes?
There's one group that's the Luddites who are afraid.
The Luddites who are afraid. Yeah. But I think even the Luddites would appreciate that they want a culture of innovation. They just don't want their particular machine or mechanism to become obsolete. But even they would say, we'd like, you know, if I'm using an obsolete machine, I'd like a better grease fitting on it. You know, if I think we're pretty safe to say that all parties at the table want a society with innovation. All right? How do you stimulate innovation? Let me ask you this. What are things that hurt or stifle innovation? If we were going to make this is after lunch, so I try to do after lunch stuff that's a little bit participatory so everybody stays awake, you know? And so how about just a little bit of, if we were going, let me do it the other way first. If we were going to have a civilization or a culture that encouraged innovation, what are some things that we could do that would encourage innovation? Yes?
Tell people that they're competing for scarce resources.
Tell people, yeah, that we're running out of things, and so you better come up with a solution. That's a good one. What?
Low fear.
What?
Low fear.
Yeah, be risk takers. Yeah, we encourage people to jump off the cliff. It's okay, you know. Be high, you know, high bungee jumpers. Okay. Yes.
Along with that, low fear, low stress.
No stress.
Low stress.
You
gotta have some stress. Keep going.
Gotta have some stress, but low stress.
Yeah.
Okay. What else?
I think the theme you talked about before about benefiting fairly from your effort, like making sure that people when they come up with something, they're gonna benefit.
Oh, yeah, great question. Okay, so a climate in which the innovator gets to keep the profits or the largesse that the idea or the prototype brings. Okay, yes?
Don't punish failure.
Yeah, you've got to have a climate that allows people to fail. And that's why innovation is very expensive. You know, I always tell people, you know, they want to come to farming, and they want to do all this, and read my books, and they see all the stuff that we're doing, and they want to do it all today. I said, no. You're reading here what we've developed over 50 years. You can't do all this in a day. Innovation is expensive. Why? Because innovation requires a lot of failure. You know, remember throwing that stuff up against the wall requires a lot of stuff that doesn't work. And so you can't be creative. You can't be innovative in every area of your business all at once. That's why you have to nail down one thing really well, make a profit, and then that profit then finances innovation over here. You get that settled, and you progress through. Yeah, good, up here, yeah. Less red tape. Okay. Now we're kind of drilling into where I'm headed here. Less red tape. Yeah, you want a very freewheeling access to market, to be able to take your prototype, like we were told right up here, and be able to market it. Let's look at it this way. Here's a great metaphor. Just imagine, everybody here knows about eBay. You have eBay here? I've never been on eBay, so I just hear about these things. All right, I'm a bit of a Luddite myself. All right, I'm still the paper pen, the legal pad guy. You know, I don't have all my talks on laptops yet. You know, they're just scrawled on legal pads. Anyway, let's take eBay. What if, we all agree it's a pretty big deal, and maybe it's a good thing that we have it. Whether you get on or not, it's a good thing. All right. Imagine if, in order to put an item on eBay, you had to go to eBay school, and you had to become a certified eBay technician. I mean, we don't want a bunch of, you know, rogues here, you know, independent coyotes out here running, you know, eBay. And okay, so now you're licensed, you're certified, you're a certified eBay, you know, practitioner. And so now we're ready to launch this thing. Well, now wait a minute. In order to have that in your house, we need to make sure that your node, your terminal to access eBay, meet certain specifications. Like, you know, we get all these hot bids back in. We don't want to melt down here. So we need to have your office certified by a licensed electrician, signed off by a bureaucrat that says that your electrical cords are not prone to failure. Okay? And you may need to run into the house pretty quick to check your eBay, you know, in case somebody made a bid. And so we need handicap access for your office. You know, that needs to be certified, licensed, you know, handicap thing. And we need to make sure that there's a functioning fire extinguisher on the wall that's been properly complied to the correct check date to make sure that it works. And then, you know, we don't want you to end up as a medical casualty when your first three bids come in and they're three times as high as you thought, and you jump up from your desk, and as you jump up from your desk at your computer, and you've got a plywood table behind you that puts a splinter in your hiney because you jumped up. So we gotta have an approved office infrastructure decor, licensed by a government official, to make sure you don't get a splinter in your hiney from jumping up in your plywood makeshift desk. I could go off, but you follow the drift, right? The question is, if that were required, would we have eBay?
No.
No! We wouldn't have it. And this speaks to the heart of innovation in culture. Because the fact is, did somebody have a really germane, you had some more hands, I'm ready to now just, you know, drive this point home, and something new, and we're going to put a little pause button right there, and we'll come back to it. But I'm very client oriented here. So when I got hands in the air, I gotta make sure everybody gets it. So we won't belabor this. But if you got something to add to stimulate innovation, tell me. Yes, ma'am. Collaboration ideas, yeah, sure. Cross-pollination of ideas. We want a culture in which we actually encourage groups to come together that aren't in the same fraternity. Can you imagine having the school board ask for members from the homeschooling community to be on the school board? Can you imagine the egg board asking for a couple of pastured poultry direct market producers to be on the egg board? Oh no, well we love our little cloister monastic fraternities of ideas where we all drink the same Kool-Aid and sign on to the same orthodoxy. Yeah, we love that. That's comforting, isn't it? Because when we get touched with other ideas, they become disturbing. We don't like disturbing things. There was one over here.
Knowledge and sharing,
okay, we're just saying ballpark. Oh, good, okay. If I could move you a little bit farther, you're talking about the tension between kind of private ownership and commons. And the commons. And it absolutely. I'm a big believer in the commons, okay, even though I'm a diehard, you know, conservative property rights guy. Absolutely, you know, if the water didn't start with you and it didn't end with you, you can't just stick a straw in it and suck water however you want to. It's a great, great, great point. Yes? Yes, ma'am.
The utilization of connect dots for, taking care of everything, it helps you. It's an innovation that you switch it out and have those animals working for you to care for other animals. And the other thing is taking wool from sheep and spinning it and weaving it. There's a lot of imagination and innovation that goes into that.
All right. So you want a culture that stimulates value adding and doing more that actually encourages you, if you're a sheep farmer, to be able to spin the wool, make a lamb quiche and sell it, and all the other things. Yes.
Clearly define the problem and communicate it widely.
Clearly define the problem and communicate it widely. What do you mean? But we don't have any problems. The government solved all our problems. Why do we have any problems at all? I mean, didn't you pay your taxes this year? I mean, the only reason you have a problem is because you're not paying enough taxes. If you just paid more taxes and gave more authority to the government, we wouldn't have any problems. They're here to babysit us and take care of us and, you know, make us all, pat us on the head and say, you know, you're all okay. Okay, yes, pay up in the back. Personal responsibility. Oh, now that's fighting words. You mean you want a culture where people are personally responsible for something? What a terrible idea. My goodness. We have people committing suicide out here if you told people they were responsible for themselves. I can't be responsible for myself. I want you to be responsible for me. You know, hey, if I get sick, I want you to be responsible for me. Oh, that makes me feel so much better. You know, I got on the metro going into D.C. the other day. I'm getting on the metro, right, the subway that goes into D.C. And a guy walks in. He gets on the metro with me. He's got his, you know, he's got his earbuds in. He's zoned out, tuned out to some, you know, who knows what. He's got a, you know, like a 5-pound bag of taco nacho chips and a 96-ounce drink, you know, about the size of a barrel of oil, you know, and he's got cigarettes in his pocket. He's 300 pounds overweight, and he sits down. I mean, takes these seats are made to sit three people, and he takes all three of them for them to sit down. And I'm looking, saying, I'm responsible for his health? Really? I'm offended. It offends me. It offends me that somebody would say, I'm responsible for his health. Whoa, now we're going to quit preaching and going to meddling now. Because in our country, if you are familiar at all with what's happening south of your border, you know, the Canadians are all perfect. Everybody is well, healthy, and health care is all taken care of, and everybody loves it. And you can go to the hospital, and you can ask for anything you want done to the moon, and it's all done, and nobody has to pay for anything. That's what we're going to have. Because Canada's perfect. All right. What do I have on this session? What am I supposed to? Listen. These are all really good. I'm going back now to the one that we dealt with the regulations, with the eBay. Okay. Here's the problem. When a government so narrowly sanctions what's available in the marketplace, it automatically stifles innovation. And I think this is one of this should be on our lips everywhere as practical farmers, as farmers who are desperate for innovation. We could name this organization Innovative Farmers. You know, might be.
It's already taken.
Oh, it's already taken? Oh, you can't be an innovative farmer. But the thing is, if we want innovation, we can't put boundaries around what's available in the marketplace. Okay? Because the marketplace is what pays the guy for his invention. We're over here. You know, you got to be able to get, you got to be able to incentivize the innovation, so a guy has to be able to profit on his or her innovative idea or thing. But when you say only pasteurized milk can be sold, what about all the people that want unpasteurized milk? And what about the guy that dares to say, I think I could actually help our society if I sold unpasteurized milk, also known as raw milk? What do you do to that? And so what happens is that when you surround every product with all of these licenses and bureaucratic control, what you actually do is deny the civilization the advantage of unfettered innovation. The only reason that our country, supposedly, is leading the world in electronic innovation and the whole everything, is because that area of business expertise and enterprise is coming faster than the bureaucracy to control it. But every other area, especially food, which was one of the first things to be controlled, food is way down at the end, because it's been able to build up a great big regulatory climate around it. And especially in Canada, the quota system, I mean, to wrap newcomers in the hurdle, the stigma, the financial and licensing whatever barrier to entry. What you have to, here's my point. Instead of saying it keeps me from being in the market, I think our messaging on this should not be, I can't enter the market, I can't do this. It should be, you are denied product. We need to message this not like it's selfish, like greedy, you know, I can't come to market with what I want to do, even though I feel that very, you know, viscerally. But we need to couch the message in, do you know what you can't get when you go to the supermarket? You can't get Aunt Matilda's homemade pickles. You can't get, local Farmer John's compost-grown tomato quiche. You can't get, homemade egg noodles. And you can make a list of the things. People go to the supermarket and they see all this, you know, cornucopia of things, but it's basically, the cleverness is all in the packaging and the clever speak labels, and it's really just refabrications of corn, soybeans, and rice. In fancier packages. You read the cookbooks from the 1800s, and there are 40 things that you and I have never even heard of. I mean, you know, choke cherries and I can't even think of them, you know, because I wasn't living there. But there are all sorts of entrance, you know, currants, you know, currant pie, currant jelly, currant, you know, who makes currant jam today? You know, elderberries, good, somebody, but not very many. You're not going to find them in the supermarket. The point is that we have actually, with our food regulatory climate, what I call the food police, we have actually reduced choice. And I use that term on purpose because we have, at least our culture, we're all about choice. Marriage choice, female choice for abortion. I mean, they didn't ask the baby, but anyway, you know, we're all about choices. We want choice. We want democratization of morality and diversity and choice. Ethnicity and multiculturalism. In fact, you know, now I realize you guys didn't throw off the queen. We did. So in our country, we have this really, this mystique, you know, dating back to 1776 of rebellion. And we kind of, in the U.S., we like rebels. We like rebels anywhere except in our own country. So we cheer, you know, we cheer for the, you know, the Syrian rebels and the Libyan rebels and the, you know, the Arab uprising and, you know, oh yeah, go, you know, the Ukrainians, yeah, you know, separate the Caledonians, you know, oh, go vote, separate, you know, and the Scottish, yeah, you know, tell the Queen to go take a hike. But boy, you know, if you don't adhere to the orthodoxy in our country, you're a terrorist. And so, innovation. I think that this whole food freedom thing, I'm a marketer of ideas, okay? And I appreciate that we need to use terminology and use the words and the phrases that garner support. That's why I start with innovation, because almost everybody wants innovation. We pride ourselves in the West, especially in the West, right, of being innovators. And so if we count food freedom as a food innovation thing, it gives us a kind of an open door. It's a better way to market the idea of eliminating the quota system or giving some room for, you know, cottage industry, you know, to go on. You would be excited to know that Virginia, where I am, in our state of Virginia, we have a constitutional amendment going into this General Assembly that says that every citizen of Virginia shall have the right to purchase food directly from the farmer who produced it for their own personal consumption. See, what's happened is, in our Bill of Rights, we have the right to own guns, the right to worship, the right to speak, freedom of the press, freedom of, you know, self-expression, we have these enumerated freedoms. What we don't have is the right to the food of our choice from the source of our choice. And the framers of the Constitution, believe me, they could have never conceived of a day in their day when it would be illegal to make a pot pie from your garden produce